Okay, so in today's class, the first 10 minutes, we look at saturation, vapor pressure and complete that concept, and then we'll take a break, then I'll distribute the quiz papers, then I'll work out the solution, right? And then we'll continue with relative humidity and so on in the next class, all right? So saturation, vapor pressure. Consider a container containing water at the bottom, and then it is at a particular temperature T. The top is empty now. There is a vapor pressure difference between the water and the top. So, automatically evaporation will take place. Okay. So, what will happen is slowly water vapor molecules will start going up. Okay. There will be recondensation of some molecules. So, that is given by the downward arrow. Evaporation is given by the upward arrow. But I have deliberately made the upward arrow longer than this, because as the vapor pressure keeps building up, when the vapor pressure keeps building up because of a consequence of the difference between the rates of evaporation and the rates of condensation. Okay. When it is fully, this is A, unsaturated, B, when it is saturated, what happens is there is no change in the temperature. Now it becomes T and PS. Okay. So now the arrows are equal. So this is vapor pressure. So this is saturation vapor pressure. Okay. So, initially upper part of container is completely dry, correct? With time, water evaporates. And PV increases, correct? With time, water evaporates and PV increases. As PV increases, rate of condensation also increases. When rate of evaporation is less than rate of condensation, the box is said to be, or the container box is said to be unsaturated, correct? Now, when PV is such that rate of evaporation? Yes, yes, sorry. Correct. Thanks. Correct? So, this PS is called the saturation vapor pressure. How does the saturation vapor pressure change with temperature? That's what we want. Any guess? Decreases. It increases with temperature. So let us see. Let us see that. It should be what, some millibar, appropriate units. So this is Tsat. When Tsat increases, so in Ooty, for example, in 2000 meters above sea level, the temperature is less. So the water will boil at less than 1.013 atmosphere. So the cooking will not be proper if it is open. So you have to do, but pressure cooking is different. Okay? Pressure cooking, the whole advantage is the whole thing is done at higher pressure, so higher temperature. Latent heat is more because you are working at a higher pressure. Is that okay? Compared to normal cooking at atmospheric pressure. Okay? So this, if you look at, for those people who are doing mechanical engineering, you know that, so this will be like this, the temperature entropy diagram for steam is like this. So this is the critical temperature, this is 374 degrees centigrade and the critical pressure is 221 bar. So this is the, okay, so this is liquid. Liquid plus vapor, and this S is entropy, okay? All right. So, but this is too high for atmosphere. This is engineered, right? You heat it and you have to burn coal and this thing and transfer the heat to water. Water will become steam, you pressurize it and all that. Okay. After saturation vapor pressure, you have to look at, we looked at mixing ratio. We'll have to now look at saturation mixing ratio, then the concept of relative humidity, and then the concept of dew point, which is a big indicator of human comfort. So, we'll do all this in the next class, saturation, mixing ratio, relative humidity, dew point. I'll explain all the concepts and all the formulae. Then with the SQT lawn P diagram given to you, we will solve a problem where we'll plot the state of moist air on the chart. So, I'll use this, the tablet, and then I'll ask you to determine the dew point and all that. And then if time permits, that is in tomorrow's class, if time permits, we'll solve one more problem so that you become familiar with the chart. Then we look at some advanced concepts like lifting condensation level of an air parcel, and when your air parcel is going beyond that level and then it condenses, then it releases some moisture as rain or water, what happens and all that. And then we look at some phenomena, okay, like Chinook wind and all that, and try to understand all these phenomena using the SQT lawn P chart, which will be extremely useful to us. Okay. Okay. So, now we look at the solution to the quiz paper. Okay. So, this is a problem set involving 5 problems. Okay. So, the first problem is the total mass of the atmosphere is known to you, okay, to all the people who have attended this course. In one of the earlier classes, we have done this, 1.004 into 10 to the power of 4 is a kilogram per meter square, and then 6373 kilometer is the radius of the earth. So, 4 pi r e squared, if you multiply by this, you will get the mass as 5.11 into 10 to the power of 18 kg. The kinetic energy of the atmosphere is of the order of 10 to the power of 21 joules. Hence, given order of magnitude estimate of the average wind speed. Okay. So, the total mass of the atmosphere is known to you, that is mass is 5.11 into 10 to the power of 18 kg. Okay. So, half mv square kinetic energy is known to be 10 to the power of 21 joules. Okay. So, half into 'll get an order estimate of the velocity, v square is of 391. So, the velocities, the average velocities in the atmosphere, air velocities are of the order of tens of meters. You can say 10, even if you put tens of meters of second, it is all right. It comes to 19.76 or something, right, 20, is it okay? So, this is a ballpark estimate, 20 meters per second, that is how much? Kilometer per hour, 72 kilometer per hour, that is a lot, no? Okay. So, it is working. The second question is, the composition of the atmosphere of Venus is given to you. So, carbon dioxide is 95.2%, nitrogen is 3.4%, sulfur dioxide is 150 ppm, argon is 70 ppm and H2O is 20 ppm. The carbon dioxide is very high, okay. So, it can lead to, it is a greenhouse gas. So, it can lead to what is called like runaway inflation, runaway increase in temperature, right. So, the Venus cannot support life. First, oxygen is not there and the temperature is expected to be very high, okay, carbon dioxide is too much, all right. Now, what is the apparent molecular mass? Somebody went very deep and found out what is U, normal atom mass and apparent molecule. I just wanted simple molecular mass, that is okay, okay. That is the first part. Then convert the volumetric analysis to a gravimetric analysis, it is a standard question, so that you are familiar in converting from volumetric or molar analysis to mass based or gravimetric analysis. And once a composition is given of any atmosphere, you should be in a position to calculate the molecular weight. From the molecular weight, you will get the gas constant and then you will use the ideal gas and you will start working out all problems. The first step is to be able to calculate the molecular weight, okay. So, which you studied long back in high school. So, molecular weight, Venusian or Venusian? What is the correct spelling for that? This is okay? Okay. So, this is nothing but M of Venus 95.2 into 44 carbon dioxide plus 28 into nitrogen 3.4 plus 64 sulfur dioxide is 64, right? 32 plus 16 into 2. Argon is 40, different people have come out with different 36, 80, some people have put argon into and left it. That is a very honorable exit that is called. Argon into something they have put, okay. 64 into 0.015 plus when you do like this, don't forget to divide by 100, okay. Okay, if you do this, let's see. So 42.85. Then the next part is to do the gravimetric analysis. CO2 I've cut some mark for some people who just left it with the N2, right? You should continue with the other things may not be very this significant, but you can write it in ppm, right? Some water is coming from somewhere. SO2 is how much? 224 ppm, correct. And then H2O was 8.4 ppm. So, I have given you the breakup of marks. Okay, so it is also given here. 97.75 carbon dioxide, nitrogen is 2.22, SO2 is 224, argon is 65 and H2O is 8.4 ppm. Pretty straightforward, many of you have done it, there is no problem at all. Okay, let's go to the third question. Third question is, using the hypsometric equation, show that the pressure decreases with increasing height at about 1 hpa per 15 meters at the 500 hpa level. I come again. So, the question is, using the hypsometric equation, show that the pressure decreases with increasing height at the rate of about 1 hpa per 15 meters at the 500 hpa level. Okay. There are several ways of solving this. You can find out what is the height at the 501 hpa level or 499 hpa level and be done with it. Or you can take the delta P to be 1 and then solve it. So, there are several ways of doing it. So, you can use the actual ipsometric equation in its actual form or in its differential form also. Okay. So, how I have done it is, so G d z you can take T to be 255 Kelvin, the mean temperature of the atmosphere, RD okay. Substitute this please tell me what this value is. People who have not solved it can solve it now. Point not 67 minus? Minus. Minus. Watch out, the minus will come. Pascal per? No. Some people have taken for 500 and 499, that is also okay. Z2 minus Z, P2 equal to P1 into e to the power of minus Z by H. Okay, but they would have taken a H of 7.5 or 8 kilometers. Okay, so Z2 minus Z1. So, you can calculate the delta Z and all that, that is also possible. But if you use 7.5 or 8 kilometers, a little bit difference will come. I have not penalized anybody for doing that. Is it okay? This is a better way of doing. The only assumption is the 255, but 255 is acceptable, that is a mean temperature. Okay. Fine. Let's go to question number 4. That was a little tricky. So the fourth question is where many people bungled. Okay. Some assumptions had to be made. See, this paper I have told you that it is not like JEE or whatever. So I told you whatever data is not there, you can make a reasonable assumption. One assumption you have to make was the lapse rate. If you make an assumption of the lapse rate, things would have become very easy for you. Okay. So, let us look at the question. Okay. The third question, T is 55, G is 9, RD is 287. So, dP by dZ is 1 by 15 h power per meter. Okay. That is the solution given there. Okay. So, this was some 6 marks depending on this. If you are left in between, I have given 3 marks, 4 marks, 6 marks, whatever. All right. Fourth question. The gross weight, balloon, basket, fuel and passengers, but not the gas in the balloon. Okay. So, we are comparing two balloons. One is a hot air balloon, the other is a helium balloon. Both will go up in the atmosphere, both will rise for different reasons. Helium is lighter than air, so it will rise. Even if its temperature is the same as a surrounding air. But the hot air balloon will rise for the same reason that the density is less, consequent upon the fact that temperature is less, therefore density is less. It will keep temperature is higher, density is less, it will keep on rising till the density inside and outside becomes equal plus whatever weight of the balloon, blah blah blah, all that. So you can do a force balance, and but that is not the question here. Watch carefully. The gross weight, balloon, basket, fuel and passengers, but not the gas in the balloon of two balloons is the same. So, m into g, what is that? M into g is the same. Okay. The two balloons are cruising together at the same altitude where the temperature is 5 degrees centigrade of the outside air and the ambient air is dry, so that we do not want you to get into a spin and use moisture, thermodynamics and all that. One balloon is filled with helium, other balloon is filled with air. One balloon is filled with helium, other balloon is filled with air. The volume of the helium balloon is 850 meter cube, okay. Now, what is given? The temperature of the other balloon, the temperature of air in the other balloon is given, 87 degrees. Therefore, the simple, the question is, what is the volume of the hot air, what is the volume of the hot air balloon, okay. So, this is the question, how do we go about solving? So, it is basically you have to write the, do a force balance, the weight will be equal to the buoyancy, which is valid for both the balloons, and we will equate it to mg. Mg is the same, therefore, you get a buoyancy relationship between the two balloons, okay. Then there will be a delta rho for the two balloons. So, your smartness lies in calculating the delta rho appropriately. If you calculate the delta rho appropriately, one volume is given, the other volume can be found out. So, the whole challenge in this problem boils down to getting the delta rho for the helium and delta rho for the hot air, okay. Let us solve this. Okay, V hot air correct, V hot air into rho infinity minus rho into g is equal to m into g, V helium equating 1 and 2. Equating 1 and 2 and getting rid of the g. Okay, what do you get? So, I have to, temperature is 5 degrees centigrade. Okay. I will make two assumptions. Ground temperature is 30 degrees. You can make it 25, whatever you want. I will take a lapse rate of 6.5. So, this is assumed. Therefore, I get an estimate of the height at which the balloon are cruising, it is about 3.8 kilometers. This is important, otherwise you will make some assumption in the pressure equal to 1.0, because it is delta rho, you may still get close. Sir, you may say, sir, I also got 3000 meter cube, but you are getting the correct answer for wrong reasons. The correct way, okay. So, this is, you can question me, sir, why not 30, 35, whatever you would have taken, I would have appreciated. Some lapse rate 6 to 7 we told in the act, that the data is also given in the notes. Assume some reasonable, so get the height. What is the fun of getting the height? Once you know the height, ipsometric equation, we can get the hydrostatic equation. What is it? Ipsometric equation. Using the ipsometric equation, you can get the pressure. Temperature 5 degrees is given. So, rho is obtained. What is this rho? Rho?
Rho infinity.
No, starter. Rho infinity. Rho infinity. So, with this, so there is a way to get rho infinity if you know only the temperature. Many people in the quiz they ask me, sir, pressure is not given, pressure is not given. That is for normal students, not for students taking atmospheric science course. You can calculate the pressure. Okay, fine. So even if a little bit here and there, instead of 3.8, you got 4.4 or 4. Yeah.
The temperature of the helium inside the balloon and the temperature outside.
I have not even come to helium. Wait. Okay. So, okay, so P T equal to 278. Now this is the same pressure for the helium also, okay? P is the same as P helium. So the P helium is basically rho so Rohan is asking me why are you using 278? Why can't you use 330 degrees, is it?
Outside temperature is 5, so why is the assumption that temperature of helium is also 5 invalid?
Only now I am making that assumption. You can make 30 also, no problem. That means I am assuming some heat transfer equilibration. Somewhere you have to make an assumption.
What if you can cancel out the whole pressure terms?
How?
P by RT, then so pressure is equal.
I am not able to do that.
We can.
Just hang on. So let me complete this. So I will take it as So, rho helium, I got it as 0.105. We will see what is the difference it makes to the result. Okay. Now, 850 What is it, 0.59? Where did I get the 0.59? From the 87 degree centigrade. Okay. Okay, so I am not saying this is the solution, this is a reasonable solution. If you get 30 degree centigrade, if you take 30 degree centigrade, you may get little bit different because the helium anyway density is very low. So the leading order term is 0.6764 only. If you make 30 degrees also, it will make little difference to the answer. Is that okay? Yes, now proceed.
Sir, actually you don't even, then if you are simply assuming the temperature of helium, then you don't even need to find pressures and all, because directly it will just cancel out in the equation.
That's okay, but I am going through, I am using a systematic procedure where what all we learnt in the course we have used. If you got approximately the 3000 something, I would have given maximum marks, but I wanted you to go through the steps. Okay. What is the other assumption? See, if I have to know more, Rohan, if you have to know more about the helium temperature, I should know the heat transfer process, whether it is elastic membrane, I would apply first law of thermodynamics and we can do that in a ME course. This is also ME course. Okay. Now, all right. Okay. V is equal to whatever I have written on the board. GG gets cancelled, lapse rate, okay. So, the pressure is 0.61 bar. Now, substituting this thing, I am getting the rho infinity to be 0.764. For helium, R is 2078.5 because 8314 divided by 4, that you should remember, molecular weight is 4. So, you can get the rho helium. So, you can get about 3000, approximately it is around 3000. If you cancel out the pressure also, you are getting like that, right? Okay. All right. So, the last problem in the quiz was, calculate for the Earth's atmosphere the height of the surface where the pressure is 0.15 of the surface value. Calculate for the Earth's atmosphere the height of the surface where the pressure is 15% of the surface value. Assuming one, uniform temperature of 290 Kelvin, two, surface temperature of 300 Kelvin and a uniform lapse rate of 10 Kelvin per kilometer. So the idea is to find out, given the pressure, find out the height. It is very easy using the ipsometric equation, but that is for an isothermal atmosphere. Your lapse rate is given, some integration has to be done, no approximation, you have to use an integration. So, the part B of the problem, I made it as 3 marks plus 5 marks. So, the first part is pretty straightforward. So, the total was 8, so it is 3 plus 5. Is it okay? Let us solve this problem now. So, any cribs, you have to meet me on Thursday or Friday afternoon, okay? Tomorrow, I am busy with the comprehensive Viva exams. So, 5, 1. All right. So, some people have got 16 kilometers, that's all right. So, you have taken a scale height of 8 kilometers. So, the interesting part is the part, second part, okay, where g dz . So please write an expression for the temperature in terms of the lapse rate. Okay. Now, okay. So let y be okay. Make the substitution. Okay. So, you get an error of 2 kilometers, you got 15.16 kilometers, now you are getting 12.8. So, you get an error of 2 kilometers as a consequence of an assumption of the isothermal atmosphere. Somebody got 2 kilometers of this thing and all, that is all weird. I think somewhere the integration went haywire. You thought 300, 1 by 300 is very easy to do, it is better. What we do is equal to z equal to y or x, something you, if you do like that, then you will not make mistakes.